We all know about the iconic Concorde that could cross the Atlantic in less than 3 hours, but the Concorde was actually not the first supersonic passenger aircraft to fly. This title actually goes to the Soviet Concorde, or the Tupolev-144. Not only was the Tupolev-144 first, but it was larger, faster, and more powerful than the Concorde. At one point, it would even be used by NASA to conduct supersonic tests. It's no doubt that the Tupolev-144 was way ahead of its time, just like the Concorde. So, here's a story of the monster Soviet Concorde that you've probably never heard of. Just like most of the other ambitious space and aviation projects, the Tupolev-144 was founded in the 1960s during the height of the Cold War. The premier, or the leader of the Soviet Union at the time, Nikita Khrushchev, heard some rumors that Britain and France were working together on a supersonic passenger aircraft. He also heard that Lockheed Martin and Boeing were working on their own supersonic aircraft. This meant that the West was already working on two supersonic passenger aircrafts, while the East was working on none. So, the Soviets immediately began work, determined to beat the West. They really had no intention of creating a plane that was comfortable or practical. Their primary goal was making a supersonic jet that was faster and more powerful than Western counterparts. Usually, such goals were actually not too difficult to achieve for the USSR, as they were willing to do whatever it took, including espionage. The Tupolev project was unique though. Being founded in the early 1960s, the USSR had their hands full with their space and missile ambitions. They had already beat the US to space, and now they had their eyes set on the moon. In order to prevent their space/missile team from getting distracted, the Soviets would establish a new standalone team that would develop the Tupolev. This was likely the Soviets' first mistake. You see, the Soviets' aviation industry was not really capable of developing the Tupolev at the time. Experts suggest that the Tupolev was 10 to 15 years ahead of the Soviets' aviation industry, so this project would have likely been executed much better if it was left to the Soviet space/missile team, who was much more advanced. Unfortunately though, that's not how things played out. Anyway, the new team would quickly get to work on the supersonic aircraft, but it would be quite a struggle. The Concorde took advantage of a variety of new technologies that the world had never seen before, which made it extremely difficult for the Soviets to match. For instance, the Concorde sported computer-controlled wings that optimized the shape of the wings to minimize drag. Similarly, the Concorde's engines were also controlled by computers that changed the shape of the air inlets to maximize engine efficiency. The Soviets wouldn't end up developing such technologies, but as they saw the West taking the lead, they would turn to their secret weapon, which was brute force. Here's the thing, you could either spend years tinkering with engines and aerodynamics to maximize the plane's capabilities, or you could just go ahead and install more powerful engines to begin with, and that's precisely what the Soviets did. Each of the Tupolev's engines could generate 44,000 pounds of thrust, which is 6,000 pounds more than the Concorde. For every problem that arose during the Tupolev development, the Soviets would use a similar strategy. If the tires are too weak, just add more tires. If the plane is not that aerodynamic, just add more engines. If the plane is too heavy, just add afterburners and so on and so forth. Though the Tupolev may seem like a Soviet copy of the Concorde at first glance, it's actually quite a bit different under the hood due to these brute force solutions. These solutions were no doubt short-sighted, but it did end up allowing the Tupolev to beat the Concorde to flight. The Tupolev would complete its first supersonic flight in July of 1969, while the Concorde wouldn't complete its first supersonic flight till October of that year. This was a major win for the Soviets. Sure, they had to use some shortcuts, but they made it all the way to the end, unlike the US, who would cancel their supersonic passenger airplane. With that, the Tupolev had successfully made its mark in history, but this was only the beginning. After all, the Tupolev was a passenger airplane, so the USSR would have to actually deploy it for commercial use. And this is where their brute force solutions would come to haunt them. Their first major failure would come in 1973 at the Paris Air Show. This was the first time that the West got to witness the Tupolev in action, and it likely would have gone well if it wasn't for the arrogance of the pilot. The Concorde had flown the day before the Tupolev was scheduled to fly, and the Concorde pilots decided to keep it extremely safe and simple. According to Time magazine, the test pilot of the Tupolev, Mikhail Kozlov, would trash-talk the Concorde team stating, quote, "Just wait until you see us fly. Then you'll see something." Mikhail would go on to attempt a super aggressive takeoff at an extremely steep angle. I think he was trying to do one of those 90-degree takeoffs like fighter jets, but this would prove to be too much for the Tupolev. Shortly after the takeoff, the plane would pitch over and basically blow up in the air. Many theories sprang up as to why the disaster happened, But the most likely one seems to be that the pilot maneuvered the plane too hard at slow speeds, which resulted in the plane losing lift. Ironically, the air show took place just miles away from the Charles de Gaulle Airport, which is where the Concorde would also have a fatal accident 27 years later. Despite this setback, the Soviets would continue to move forward in deploying the Tupolev as a commercial airliner. They would start by completing cargo trips in 1975 and eventually transition to their first passenger trip in 1977. From the very beginning though, Soviet leadership didn't really care about the Tupolev succeeding as a passenger aircraft. As we discussed at the beginning, the primary goal of the Tupolev was to beat the West to supersonic travel, and the Tupolev had already accomplished that. Moreover, the US had beat the USSR to the moon, and so the USSR was busy trying to beat the US to Mars. So, the Tupolev became a backburner project that no one really cared about. The Tupolev would serve as a route between Moscow and present-day Almaty, Kazakhstan. This route was chosen as it mainly flew over rural land with little population. However, the obscurity of the route also meant that not very many people were interested in the service, and so the Tupolev would often fly with only half capacity. The passengers who did fly on the Tupolev often complained that the noise produced by the engines and the air conditioning was unbearable. Aside from being uncomfortable, the Tupolev was also super dangerous. The Tupolev only completed a total of 55 passenger flights, but throughout these trips, the plane experienced hundreds of failures. Cabin depressurizations and engine failures were extremely common. Landings were also super sketchy, as the plane had to use parachutes to slow down. Likely the biggest red flag of the plane's danger was the fact that the designer of the plane, Alexei Tupolev himself, had to personally inspect the plane before each flight. Fortunately, Aeroflot, who was the operator of the jet, would pull the plug before any passenger fatalities would take place. But this wasn't until a test flight crash in 1978, which claimed the lives of two crew members. Despite passenger flights being stopped, Tupolev 144 production would actually continue till 1982, at which point the Soviets had 14 jets remaining. They used these jets for cosmonaut training purposes throughout the 1980s, but at this point, the Tupolev was basically all but dead. You would think that the Tupolev was heading to the museums, but surprisingly, the Tupolev's life would be extended for another decade out of nowhere. In the 1990s, NASA would start to work on their own supersonic plane with the high-speed research program. However, since the US had never built their own supersonic passenger plane, NASA would seek out the help from people who did. They would of course start by trying to work with the Europeans, but British Airways and Air France had all of the remaining Concordes, and they didn't want to take a plane out of service to be used for testing. So, NASA would turn to Russia. By this point, the USSR had already collapsed, and the threat from Russia was rather low. President Bill Clinton actually wanted to work with the Russian aviation industry. This way, they could ensure that the genius Russian aerospace engineers worked on something positive with the US, instead of drifting away and working with Iran or something like that. Eventually, in 1993, an agreement was made, which allowed NASA to lease a Tupolev 144 for experimentation. Originally, a couple of Russian pilots were assigned to fly the plane for the experiments, but the pilots were not allowed to communicate with NASA officials, which made it hard for NASA to really gather much data. So, NASA decided to send their own pilots to Russia to conduct experiments with the Tupolev 144. One of these pilots would be Rob Rivers, and the other would be Gordon Fullerton. These two men would end up being the only two Western people to ever fly the Tupolev 144. Rob Rivers previously had experience flying the Concorde as well, meaning that he was the only person in the world to fly both the Concorde and the Tupolev. Anyway, NASA would end up making a couple of adjustments to the plane to make it safer, and they would conduct several tests using the plane. But once NASA was done in 1998, the Tupolev would finally be retired. Today, the remaining Tupolev 144s are stored in various museums and hangars around the world. One notable example is a display found in a technical museum in Germany, where the Tupolev 144 and the Concorde are placed side by side. At the end of the day, the Tupolev 144 and the Concorde were both way ahead of their time, trying to accomplish something much greater. The Concorde did end up getting much more popular and iconic, but don't let that sway you to discount the Tupolev 144. After all, as pilot Rob Rivers said, Tupolev created a remarkable plane that could do what only one other plane in history could do. What do you guys think about the Soviet Concorde? Comment that down below. Also, drop a like if you guys would love to see supersonic planes make a return to the passenger airline industry. And of course, consider joining our Discord community to suggest future video ideas, and consider subscribing to see more questions logically answered. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.